Recently, this happened.
Soft capture confirmed.
SpaceX launched its Crew Dragon, marking the first time that a commercially built crew capsule launched from American soil. This is exciting all on its own, but this upcoming Soyuz launch could also mark the end of an era and what could be the last time Americans are sent to space in a country other than their own. Expedition 5960 is expected to launch on March 14th from the Baikonur Cosmodrome in Kazakhstan, ferrying the new crew to the ISS, including astronauts from October's failed abort mission. The two astronauts and one cosmonaut will be joining the crew already aboard the ISS, working on roughly 250 experiments to further our understanding of the human body, test new technology, and even try to further wrap our brains around what time means in space. This latest mission will be on a Soyuz MS-12 spacecraft, carrying a three-person crew. Alexei Ovchinin of the Russian space agency Roscosmos, NASA astronauts Christina Hammett-Koch, and Nick Haig. For Ovchinin and Haig, this is their second attempt to make it to the ISS. On October 11th, 2018, the pair were headed for a routine trip to the space station on a Soyuz rocket. But 2 minutes after liftoff, a problem occurred during the separation of one of the rocket's strap-on boosters, forcing them to perform an emergency landing via ballistic re-entry, which sounds scary and is scary, but it's actually the only way astronauts used to re-enter at the beginnings of human space travel. Since then, Ovchinin and Haig have been retrained and are prepared for Expedition 5960. We got in touch with Haig, currently stationed in Star City, Russia, and spoke to him about his feelings of heading back after only a few months.
Well, you know, if you asked me a year ago if I'd be in this position, I could have never imagined it. So it's a little bit surreal. Being able to have another opportunity this quickly. But I feel very fortunate for the opportunity to be able to get up there and you know, finally get to doing the mission that I've been training for at NASA for the last 5 years.
Expedition 5960 will be making history as they will be on board when the first commercial crew vehicles are scheduled to arrive at the ISS, having launched from Cape Canaveral in Florida. The US hasn't launched astronauts into space from its own soil since 2011. Since then, astronauts have been ferried to and from Earth via Russian Soyuz rockets. But this agreement is due to run out by the end of 2019. Now, there's a chance that they may have the opportunity to buy more seats, but the overall goal is to get back to launching from the US. So why did the US stop ferrying its astronauts to space? Officially named the Space Transportation System, NASA's Space Shuttle program had its first flight on April 12, 1981. The Space Shuttle program was the world's first reusable rocket, shuttling astronauts, repairing satellites, and even helping to build the ISS. During its reign, the program had 5 space shuttles that flew a total of 135 missions. But by 2011, one estimate put the average cost per trip to roughly $1.5 billion. So after 30 years of service, NASA decided to retire the program. Since then, the US has been entirely dependent on Russia, as the Soyuz is the only spacecraft available to transport crews to the ISS. And they're pretty reliable. The Soyuz is the longest operational manned spacecraft in history. Although, it's expensive. The US currently pays $81 million per seat for its astronauts to hitch a ride, which is why in 2014, NASA decided to spend its coin in the private sector, awarding both SpaceX and Boeing with contracts to build spacecraft that could shuttle astronauts. In the long term, this also means that NASA has more resources available to tackle challenges like deep space exploration and getting to Mars. To be ready for the task, SpaceX built its Crew Dragon spacecraft that sits atop a Falcon 9. Its first test flight, dubbed Demonstration 1, launched on March 2nd from Kennedy Space Center, making history as the first commercially made American spacecraft and rocket to launch from the US. After a day in Earth's orbit, the capsule successfully docked into the ISS, delivering its spacesuit, sensor-wearing test device named Ripley, and roughly 180 kilograms of supplies. It remained docked for roughly 5 days before making its descent back to Earth, splashing down into the Atlantic Ocean. The other contract was awarded to Boeing, whose CST-100 Starliner capsule is scheduled for its uncrewed test launch in April 2019. Starliner is designed to be reused at least 10 times within the span of 6 months. SpaceX and Boeing are continuing tests, but both have committed to manned space missions for later this year. NASA has already assigned the crew that will be heading up on these historic flights, and although Crew Dragon and Starliner are built to carry 7 passengers, for these first operational missions, they'll carry only 4 crew members along with roughly 100 kilograms of cargo. By having different launch capabilities, it provides more launch options when needing to replan an aborted launch, like what happened to Ovchinen and Hague back in October.
This is going to make the program much more robust by having multiple means to launch from, whether it's the US, whether it's Boeing, or whether it's SpaceX, or whether it's on a Soyuz. We've got all these ways to deliver crews so that if we do have a problem, we're more resilient and we don't have to bring down the size of the crew of the station and put a damper on the research, and we can continue to move forward at the pace that we want to.
Because at the end of the day, it's also about the really cool science happening on board the ISS. Right now, there are roughly 250 scientific experiments stationed aboard, sent up on previous missions from different space agency partners, looking to study various aspects of life in space. These experiments include how to grow food in microgravity, or monitoring lightning from space that happens every second, or how astronauts experience bone density loss during expeditions. Before heading up, the astronauts get training so they're able to handle the experiments, and they can even volunteer for them, like the airway monitoring program sent up by European Space Agency to help study astronauts' lung function on the ISS. The study looks at the nitric oxide that astronauts breathe out, which helps in understanding the conditions of our lungs in space. Monitoring nitric oxide levels helps to detect inflammatory diseases in the lungs, like asthma. Previous crews of astronauts have volunteered for the experiment, like German ESA astronaut Alexander Gerst.
And we also found that spaceflight triggers a little bit the reaction of the lungs that are very close to what people have when they have asthma. So we can still breathe freely in space, so it's not really stopping us from working and living there. But we can still use that little change to measure that, right? And we can understand it better because we are in a much more controlled environment than it's possible down here on Earth.
For Expedition 5960, Nick Hague volunteered to be the human test subject for the experiment.
So the benefit is when we get to the surface of the moon and there's dust, and we know we had problems with lunar dust back in the Apollo program, we're going to be able to monitor the health of the astronauts even better while they're working up there and diagnose problems and protect us while we're exploring the moon. Space is not easy. It's a risky business. It's always going to be a risky business, but why do we do it? We've been up there for two decades on the space station in this amazing international collaboration, performing science, collecting data so that scientists on the ground can learn more about our planet. They can learn more about humans and our bodies and how they behave. They can learn more about the universe that surrounds us. And all of that is advancing humanity. And so we accept those risks so that we can continue to move forward and continue to expand the boundaries of what we know. It's a vital mission, and we're doing it every day. And I want people to, when they see a launch like that, I want them to connect that launch with the importance of the mission.
And that's just it. There are so many launches happening every year. So many historic moments that aren't to be missed, which is why we're committed to bringing you more launch coverage than ever before. That means we'll be there to talk about the next Crew Dragon launch, Boeing Starliner, and the latest international moon missions. And if there's anything you'd like us to cover on future missions, let us know down in the comments. And as always, thanks for watching Seeker, and I'll see you next time.